All right, we good. Joe Brinkman and Brian Keane, how you doing, boys?
Good.
Good. Yeah, thanks for having us.
Awesome. Now, you guys are coming from Boston College, and I've just moved from Boston, so had a great 7 months there. Beautiful place to live. I'm living out in Irvine, California now, so I can't really complain about that either. So, Joe, listen, it was nice to meet you and get to see your facility that you're running there as the head coach. And just tell us, how did you end up getting to Boston College yourself?
Yeah, well, I guess you and I kind of came around the same time. I beat you by a few months. I got here in August of last year, so it still hasn't been a full calendar year yet. But, I was out in California this summer after my time at Notre Dame ended, and the timing just ended up being right. When the job came available, it was certainly an opportunity that I'd seen when I was in the ACC and always kept an eye on the program as it got better and better every year. So I was really excited about continuing that trajectory and improving upon that. And, bringing my brand and Brian's brand of coaching and swimming into this program and seeing how far we could take it. So just really, really excited about how things transpired over the last year. And just even more excited about keeping it going for year two.
Yeah, that's awesome. Brian, what about you? You're kind of from the area. So when this job opened up, you must have been pretty excited.
Yeah, you can say that. I mean, Joe's probably got a good story for you about that. But when this job opened up, it was pretty sweet because I'm a Boston guy. I'm from here, born and raised. So it's kind of like I guess you could put it up there as a dream school to end up and really build upon the program. But shot Joe a few phone calls and text messages when he was hired. Just to land here. So,
yeah, he was annoying.
That's the way it should be. You should be annoying. Yeah. If you want a job, you go after it. But that's a good point though. Like what is it, when you're looking for a staff or you're looking for an assistant coach, what are you looking for, Joe?
Yeah. Well, I think the first thing that I was looking for was somebody that I could get along with really well, because we only have one full-time assistant on our staff. And so I was going to be spending a lot of time, with the person I hired, making a lot of decisions in step with them, giving them a lot of autonomy. So definitely somebody who I know could on deck take care of business, was a good coach, but more importantly was somebody in the office who'd have a good relationship with, someone off deck, wouldn't mind, picking up the phone and just chatting and talking things through. So the first time I met Brian, we actually took him to an oyster bar in downtown Boston. So he checked the box of that one, big oyster fan. So the oysters were great. Conversation was great. I felt like it was a really good mesh. We had similar thoughts on how we wanted to approach the sport, and our experiences in swimming were kind of similar in terms of how we just love the sport. And so it came together pretty well in that conversation and made the decision to make a move and hire him the next day. And again, it's been best decision I've made for the program. I'm really happy to have Brian on, and he's done a fantastic job this year, continues to do a great job, and somebody that is really, really crucial to the success of this program.
That's awesome. I love it. Yeah, that's the way to do it. Hey, Brian, I obviously moved to Boston 7 months ago and for the first time, and didn't know much about Boston itself. What does it mean to kind of grow up in that area? What is Boston like? When people kind of ask me about it, they're like, "What's it like? What kind of city is it?"
Yeah, I mean, one, we're a city where if you want to come and get all four seasons, you're getting summer, spring, fall, and winter, and you're getting them in full force. But for me, I grew up in a great time in Boston where sports were just, it was it. I mean, it still is, of course, and everybody loves it around here, but you had the most tremendous athletes coming through this city. Mm-hmm. And for, there's just so much tradition and culture. And I joked with someone yesterday and said, there's so much history here that Boston just feels like coming home.
Yeah.
Wherever you're from, Boston just has that, place that it's homey. It feels like, it's got a little special place in everybody's heart when they come through, no matter if they're born and raised here, they spend a couple months here, whatever. There's something here that there's just the people, the spark, it's a fun city to be a part of.
Yeah, I agree with that. Moving out to Irvine, the first thing I noticed straight away is like people don't necessarily look you in the eye and say good morning, say hello, how you doing? Like I was walking down the street on Sunday morning. He went to get a coffee, and everybody I passed, I was like, "Hey, good morning. How's it going?" And like no one would respond. And like coming from Boston, it was like the opposite. Like everyone was so cool down there and welcoming.
Talk to you a bunch of times.
Yeah. Yeah, definitely felt like that. But yeah, so well then, Joe, like what attracted you then? Like this is your first head coaching job, right?
Yeah. The opportunity itself was attractive. Being a head coach in Division I program and best conference in swimming, the ACC was certainly what was kind of on the front part of that.
Yeah.
But even more so was the opportunity to take a program that, you know, we don't have scholarships. We don't have the opportunity to offer athletes, athletic aid upon the recruiting process. But what can we do with the infrastructure we have here? Right? The ceiling is so, so far away. Right? What can we do to climb towards that every single day, every single year? And that whole process is what really, really excited me. And what continues to excite me about being here as a head coach and having, you know, the ability to make some decisions and create an environment like we have here that is conducive to high level swimming and really produces not only just a really deep passion and love for the sport, which I think is our primary objective, but on top of that, just a desire to be better on a daily basis. And what does that look like? Is that being a better teammate? Is that being a better swimmer? Better at details, this and that. There's so many things that we get to work on because there's so many ways for us to continue to climb that ladder. And so it's an endless array of things every single day and ways to approach our training, ways to approach creating the environment we have, ways to approach recruiting. And that to me is just really, really exciting. It's not like we're pigeonholed into one thing. And we don't also have a history of just high level swimming across the board. So we're not comparing ourselves to what we've done. It's you know, what can we do? How good can we be? And that's an exciting feeling.
Yeah. Brian, when, you know, I imagine you're doing a lot of kind of the general gathering of information on recruits, you know, and probably feeding that to Joe, which is great, which is what an assistant should be doing. So like when you're gathering that information, looking at that, what are you looking for in recruits to pass on to Joe?
Yeah. I mean, the first thing that we always look at is just how's the first conversation? What's the personality like? You know, if they're able to carry on a conversation and really mesh with us, we have a very personable team. There's a lot of high energy on our team. We have a good team culture that we're looking for somebody that's going to fit that mold. And I don't care if, you know, it's a dude that goes 134 or a dude that goes 139. Yeah. You know, I want to hear that, you know, kind of the personality background that you have and what you're going to bring here as a person as much as an athlete.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, absolutely. And I mean, the other factor is that it's a great school, right? Like Boston College is highly academic. So Joe, like what are some of the challenges that you face when you're talking to recruits in just getting them into the school itself?
Yeah, well, it's the ultimate filter. You know, you have to be a good student to be able to get in here. And, you know, so finding the right athletes is certainly a process when we go through recruiting, you know, now that we can start a little earlier on June 15th going into their junior year. So it takes time to not only get to know them as a person, like Brian talked about, but then, you know, right out of the gate, we're asking for transcripts, we're asking for schedules, we're asking for test scores if they have them, anything we can do to give them to our admissions team and try to begin that process as early as we can, give them as much information as they can so that they can talk to our recruits and the people that we're trying to bring into the program to say, hey, you need to make adjustments to your schedule or you got to be better here. So it's a process. It's definitely something that's ongoing and it's all the way through, you know, the better part of their senior year, even as we get closer and closer to them being on campus. So it's not for the faint of heart. You can't just come here and want to just, you know, be able to wear the BC and want to swim here. There has to be a passion and an excitement about getting the level of education that you're going to have here. And that's one of the things that I really enjoy about being a part of this program is the expectation academically. You know, you're not just here with a full head of steam in the pool, but you have a lot going on. You have to be very focused academically, very focused athletically. So when you graduate, you're very well-rounded. You've had an experience that's forced you to manage your time very efficiently. And I really do think we have a team full of people that do that very, very well. And it's led to some, you know, our graduating seniors being in a great spot professionally when it's time to move on from the pool.
Yeah. One of the things that surprised me a little bit about Boston, Brian, is just how academically astute it is, right? Like in terms of like you in a small radius of Boston, there's something like five or six colleges, isn't there?
Yeah, it's nuts. We're literally like the ultimate college, I guess you'd call it college city instead of a college town, because right. I mean, just within our radius here, it's, we got Harvard, MIT, Boston University, BC mm-hmm. here, Northeastern's right down the street. So, mm-hmm. you know, right there, it's four D1 schools literally in a less than 3 mile radius of each other.
Yeah.
So that makes it fun from a student athlete perspective. But, you know, I think the big thing is we get a lot of jobs. There's a lot of jobs when you graduate within Boston, mm-hmm. but then the Northeast in general. I mean, it's a hot spot to be in. But Boston right now, it's flourishing with jobs and a lot of young people moving here.
What are the majority of the student athletes coming to study, Joe? What do you think at Boston College?
Well, our big draw is the Carroll School of Management. So mm-hmm. the finance business sector of our school is right. definitely the biggest draw and the biggest
challenging to get into.
Yeah, it's definitely the toughest school to apply into. And you can apply after you get in, after you go the arts and sciences route, but even then it's even more selective. So that's a tough one. We have people in biology and the sciences. Another very, very popular one actually is our nursing program. Yeah. One of the few schools that has a nursing program and also allows you to be a student athlete. And that's a program that we have to navigate some conflicts of practice and this and that, but it's still one that, you know, we're very proud of that we can pair athletics and academics with. Those are probably the three big ones. We have a fantastic arts and sciences school and a number of majors that our athletes participate in, but those are the major ones and those are the big draws and the ones that, you know, our athletes can come in and they can, again, pair being a student athlete full time and not really have a whole lot of overlap and not have to miss a lot of practice. And it's a manageable school to be able to do that in, which, you know, we're very happy about. We don't have to constantly look at everybody's individual schedule and you know, break that down and try to identify different practice times. It's one that they go in, they plan their schedules ahead of time. We send out the practice schedule ahead of time. They work with professors. They work with counselors, and they schedule around what we're doing in the pool. And that's been really, really good. Just the relationship between the athletics and the university side of things.
That's awesome. Bron, you know, one of the things that really blew me away is when I walked on campus, just how beautiful the campus is itself, how amazing the pool facility was. Like, you guys have some pretty amazing facilities just walking around campus.
Yeah, we're real lucky. We are. Just from a, you know, an athletic standpoint, our facilities here, the pool, it's pretty much brand new. It's 5 years old. Mm-hmm. So we got 14 lanes. We got 10 of a main competition pool, and then we got four, which we call the pit. And it's where we do a lot of the strength work. We're on racks and towers, and the speed guys really like to be in there. It's a little bit warmer too for them, I think. But no, from a, you know, we're lucky that we also get to use football's strength and conditioning center over at Fieldhouse, which that is a huge plus. It's state of the art, massive, that we can fit our entire team in there and work with a great staff over there. That was a noticeable difference for me, number one, coming in as a coach, but two, just the team really getting stronger with that core and the tools that they have over there.
Yeah, yeah, the facilities are amazing.
Campus itself is stunning, and we got new buildings going up. And we were joking around the other day that somehow the buildings just still all match, and the architecture has been able to really flourish around campus and make it seem like it was all built at the same exact time.
Right, right. Yeah, it's gorgeous.
Yeah, we were actually just yesterday. We were walking some recruits around and went to some different spots in the library, and we got beautiful views of the Boston skyline, beautiful views of the. Just the area around, and it's just gorgeous, especially this time of year. But it's a four-season school. We really enjoy being able to walk out of the pool every day and just be in awe of where we are.
Yeah. Now the situation when they do come in, the housing situation, I believe they live on campus for 3 years, Brian, do they?
Yeah, so it's one thing that BC does is we guarantee 3 years of on-campus housing. So we're a little unique because freshman, sophomore year, the student athletes or the students in general are on campus. And then their junior year, they head off. Now we have a sweet little deal where we have a off-campus house that a landlord has been really great to us and has turned it over to the swim and dive and team holding. But then they come back on campus because the senior housing here on campus is pretty phenomenal. It's a lot better than a lot of the brand new apartments that are going up in Boston, which those are something as well. So it's, you know, have those here, and for the kids to want to come back and be right next to our senior living areas are all right next to the pool and the athletic facilities. So their walk is like 2 minutes from, you know, wherever they're going to be.
Yeah. That's awesome. Hey, Joe, you know, look, when I first moved from America, from Australia to America, one of the things that I just presumed is that, you know, you go to college, all things are equal. And one of the things I learned very quickly is not everything's equal in colleges, right? Like each college has their strengths and weaknesses based on location and funding and all sorts of different issues that, you know, facilities, all that sort of stuff, all the stuff that we've been talking about. So when you're in the ACC, it's a very, very competitive conference, right? And you're competing against teams that are fully funded, right? That have scholarships. So it's difficult, right? Like when you look at that, you think to yourself, wow, we're at a disadvantage. But then when you look at the academic side, the facility side, even, you know, you guys as young coaching staff, like you guys have your own advantages, right? So like, do you weigh it up like that? And when you're talking to recruits of like, these are the thing, you know, we're in the ACC, which is highly competitive, but at the same time we have this and that.
Yeah, I think it's really easy, or would be really easy, to dwell on some of the disadvantages. And, you know, certainly when you kind of lay it all out there, you know, we're a program that's, again, surging, but it's not like we're, like you said, all things equal with every other program in the conference. Right. But we really dwell on what we're different. We really try to be unique and separate ourselves. And what Brian and I really commit ourselves to on a daily basis, and everything really spreads itself out from there, is we are striving, not only as a staff, but as a team, to provide and just have one of the more enjoyable competitive environments, individual and swimming. Okay. And that's a very simple message, but it's something where we're trying to get people on deck every day to not only just love swimming, right? Because I think if you love swimming and you enjoy the process of it, right? And to love swimming is to enjoy the process. You can't just love going fast all the time. You got to be able to put the work in to get there. But enjoy being around the team here. Enjoy being a part of the program. Enjoy working with our staff. You know, really identifying what it's going to take to be good, what it's going to take to, you know, get to the next level. What are the next goals we're trying to get after? That whole process, I think, is pretty unique in how Brian approached that. And, you know, I really do think that because we're a little bit younger in the sport, a little younger on the staff, I think we're probably one of the youngest staffs, I guess it's just us too, in the ACC. So we've got a lot of energy. We bring a lot of energy on deck every day. Our thought process, I think, throughout each week and throughout the season is always evolutionary too. We're not super stuck in what we're trying to do. We're always just, you know, the main goal is just make the athletes better in the pool. And how are we going to do that? You know, maybe our thought process changes as we go through the season, changes year to year. It always depends on what athletes we have in the water too. But it all goes back to that main mission, you know, again, make this the most enjoyable competitive environment in Division I swimming. And then as it evolves and continues to grow and stack, you know, years and seasons on top of itself with that mindset, I really do think that we're going to begin narrowing the gap, you know, and all of a sudden that gap is going to be obsolete. And then people are going to be like, oh, we don't have what BC has. We don't have this, we don't have that. And that's kind of flipped the narrative a little bit. So we don't talk about it. We really don't highlight it. It certainly is there, but it's something that our alumni, our athletes in the pool, our parents, our administration is in full support. We're all kind of behind this movement and the growth of the program, and it's just a very exciting time to be a part of BC.
That's awesome. Brian, I heard the word enjoyment a lot there. Like, what does that mean to you on the pool deck? And then when you wake up every day as an assistant coach, what do you recognize as your role in this whole, you know, organization where, you know, as soon as you walk on deck, you know exactly what to do?
Yeah. I mean, I'm a lot of high energy, especially when we're on deck. I like to get the kids laughing and enjoying what they're doing, but then, you know, getting down to it. And I push each one of them in their own unique way. I think that's where I kind of pride myself in that I can get to know every single one of them from a individual basis and understand who they are as person, as an athlete, as a student, that when you understand that, you figure out how to motivate them. And everybody's going to be a little bit different in that sense. And you can't just go, you know, it's not just motivating a whole group, but it's motivating each individual person. And for me, that's kind of been the on-deck presence that I think I've been able to bring to the team here, is that I'm going to push you. and I'm going to push you in the way that you need to be pushed, and we're going to go fast. I think Joe and I are both overly confident in our coaching, and I think we always can learn and kind of expand our what we need to do here and change things up. But, you know, we love working with this group, and this group has really bought into the two of us, and we're proud of that, and we're happy that we get to work with them each day.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Joe, I was going to say to you, like, every year your philosophy kind of it doesn't change completely, but obviously you'll keep a lot of the things that you believe in. You'll tweak some others. What's been your philosophy this past season in terms of the way that you've trained your athletes?
Yeah, well, I think it's always going to evolve. And now our situation is a little different going into year two than it is going to year one. Right. Obviously getting to know the athletes, getting to know what their, what their events are, what kind of team do we have? How is it composed? Even forecasting what we want that to look like at the end of the year. And so I think early on, we really just wanted to get things going. We wanted to swim fast early. We wanted to sustain that throughout the year. And so we had a philosophy right out of the gate where we were going to race a lot. We had a lot of dual meets in the fall. Mm-hmm. And I wanted everyone to see themselves getting better, right? So it's different than just kind of in practice, watching times be different or doing whatever measurements or metrics to see improvement in training. I wanted that to be just a real hard fact on the scoreboard and watch that get faster as we go through the fall. And I think that inspired a lot of confidence in not only myself and Brian and the training that we were doing, but also in each other and themselves. Top to bottom, we got better. And we watched that continue throughout the year. So now the philosophy is going to be a little bit different, but still on the same idea that, especially when we get on the blocks, like there's no meat we're taking off. There's no opportunity to prove ourselves as a group, as a team, that we're going to take for granted. And we've got a pretty good meet schedule this year. We're really excited about that. We'll release that soon. But continuing to really hone in on the competitive side of it and the racing side of the sport, letting the work really allow us to do that, never really finding ourselves too lost or too complicated in what we're doing on a daily basis, keeping it pretty simple with the objective of fast swimming. And so that is really the philosophy that we have. And it adapts, it evolves. And like I mentioned a little earlier, it really changes depending on who we have in the water too. So we lost athletes to graduation, yeah. Bringing athletes in recruiting. And so our philosophy and how we're going to go through the week and how we're going to cycle things is going to change. We're going to keep a lot of our core thoughts and core training pieces in place, but maybe in different places in the week. But all that's going to come together, I think, to have another unique year and a unique training system. And that will continue to be how we work on a year-to-year basis. And it's exciting, too. It keeps it kind of fresh. It's not like, Tuesday, we've been doing the same Tuesday practice for the last 5 years, this and that. It's fresh for us. It's fresh for the athletes. And I think that's another reason that I think we have the enjoyment and the excitement and the confidence that we have, is it's not just the same mundane stuff every day. We work really hard to find those opportunities to challenge them, keep them on their toes, and not feel like they're just stuck in the same spot.
How do you guys do that, Brian, between each other, you and Joe? How do you communicate the workouts before you get to the pool deck with each other in terms of what you're going to be coaching that day, what you're going to be leading, that sort of thing?
Yeah, I mean, we have a plan, of course, full year and then down a month and then down to week, right? So we know what we're going to be doing each week at the beginning of the start of the week and kind of communicate that. Joe and I aren't people that are like going to sit down and be face to face with each other. It's like, we got a thought, he's calling me. It's like,
right.
It's 4 o'clock in the morning, we're driving to practice. He's like, all right, guess what we're doing? I got an idea. Right. And so it's one of those things that at times there's a plan and it's maybe structured, but then at other times, we're going on and we an idea just pops in and we right. roll with it. Yeah. There's always that structure throughout the week and throughout the month, but we're always day to day. It's kind of changing on the fly at times because we're just thinking of new stuff and seeing too, like how each athlete is or how the group is overall. So I think, as much as there is structure going into the week, at the same time, what keeps them on their toes and us also continuing to be on our toes and really getting the most out of them is just watching them on a day-to-day basis. And if we have to change things up, we do. And
yeah,
so, but we share workouts before we're coming in, and half the time we're like, 30 minutes before practice, we're like, no, 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 I got a better idea. And throw something else in. So
I remember those days. Yeah.
Yeah. It's fun.
Yeah. 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 The best part about a plan is that you can change it. You know, you can always vary and then know where kind of the middle of the road is. And I think Brian obviously does a fantastic job of that. And I'm glad that he can flow with my thought process too. As you go through a week and a season, it's you know, a little sporadic at times, and he kind of brings you back to the center. But I think we complement each other pretty well in that. And it does make it really fun for us just going throughout a week. And I think the athletes see the consistency in how we do things and how we roll through the week. And that gives them just some confidence. And, you know, there's not a whole lot of anxiety about how the week is going to go in terms of training, but every once in a while there are some surprises and there are some opportunities for them to get on the block and, you know, that are unscripted. And we really love doing that stuff. And I think it just continues to galvanize our program.
What about in terms of communicating to the athletes? I went through phases of, like, I'd walk in with a piece of paper and I'd kind of share it with everyone. Then other times I would just, like, write the warm up and they'd do that. Then I'd write the preset. Then I'd write the main set. Like, so, like, I figured out different ways to communicate as I went, you know. But what do you guys do these days?
For us, we're paper. We show them everything at the start of practice. Yeah. And I think for a couple of reasons. I think the biggest one right now, though, is just kids want to understand and see everything.
Right.
You know, they're, so for us to hand this to them, they see it before practice. You know, they're coming in 10, 15 minutes early, you know, before we're about to jump in, and they see the whole thing. You know, they're knowing what we're doing from the very start of warm up to the very end of warm down, that they can kind of mentally prepare themselves through it. And sometimes it's a good thing, sometimes it's not. And I think, you know, there are days where once a week, and I don't know how much they love it, but we throw them up on the blocks and they have no idea what they're doing when they step on the blocks. And Joe goes, all right, goggles on. And he goes, okay, take your mark, 50 free, go. And it's just one of those things, they have no idea what they're doing. And I think you get a balance of both, but we're paper almost every day.
And they
love it. They like seeing the entire practice.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, well, and kind of like we touched on before too, we're not afraid to make the changes on the fly, you know. And if then any change, when we're right up on the board, and so it's on paper, they can see it. And any change we make, for the most part, will be consistent with how that work looks too. So it's not, no, scratch that now. Instead of going long and easy, we're going to go all out. You know, it's always, all right, this is how we look in the water. Maybe let's make an adjustment to the back part of this. So it's never chiseled in stone. But I agree with Brian. I think it just allows for everybody to kind of comprehend the day's work. You know, understand what the goal of the practice is and what the goal of the day is and what that looks like in the greater picture of things. And it also allows us to track our own progress. You know, what kind of work were we doing in the beginning of the year? How has that evolved? You know, we're also not adverse to just throwing things up on the whiteboard too. Mostly in the summer, I think we've been just experimenting and trying some new things and using the markers. But I think having a system where you can kind of log things and see how things are improving and see how the work is growing is really important.
Yeah. What about you, Joe? Who you're a young head coach. So, like, who are your mentors to get to this point where you felt like, yeah, I'm ready to be a head coach now?
Yeah. Well, I mean, I was always confident in myself. I think I was applying for head coaching jobs right out of college. So, I think I had a little bit of that in me, but, glad that I didn't get the opportunity to have a program that young. Glad I had the chance to work with some great coaches along the way. My first opportunity was, as a full-time coach, was working at Alta Swim Club with Joey Cimentelli. He was the volunteer for the Stanford women at the time. And that was, you know, certainly in their heyday. They're winning national titles. And so Greg as well, is my time on deck. But I became the volunteer for the men's program the year after I started out there. So Ted Knapp and working with Jeff Kostoff and being able to see that program work and operate the way it did. And, you know, working with some pretty spectacular athletes. But just being on that deck and being in the room with that program at that time was just a spectacular opportunity to hear the conversations, you know, even just listen to someone talk about what they thought about the practice or listen to someone talk about what they thought about an NCAA rule change, you know, and opinions like that. Right. So it was awesome, you know, is just keeping my ears peeled all the time. And then, you know, I moved on to Notre Dame and working with Mike Litzinger and Aaron Bell and Mitch Dansky. It was just really an opportunity to get some different perspectives on training and continue to really develop my own. I think Notre Dame was one of the first times when I really started to put pen to paper about my thoughts on how training should go and this and that, and continuing to build some confidence that I could lead a program. And so after my time at Notre Dame, I was there for 4 years. It was a fantastic opportunity that presented itself here in BC. Not only did I had the confidence already, but now I had the substance to it to really be able to, I think, run a program effectively and efficiently and in a way that is, again, kind of in line with our mission and enjoy it. But I think the bottom line to all of it is I just love the sport. And I don't think that this, at the end of the day, is the most complicated job in the world. And it's hardly a job to me. This is something I just love to do. I wake up in the morning just really excited to work with the athletes and, you know, work with Brian and just be around people that share the same passion.
That's good, man. Well, you guys keep it that way. That's the best way to work. Once it becomes other than that, then it becomes a drain and a strain on you and the family. And you don't end up being the best coach you could possibly be. So, like, yeah, keep that attitude. Look, I was attracted to you guys from the moment I got to Boston. You guys was standing out. And, like I said, I had a couple experiences to come out there and get to see what you guys have and what you're doing. And it looked like a special place to me. So it's certainly one of those ones where I think if you're considering any school in Boston, BC is the one that I'd be looking at for sure. So you guys are doing some good things, guys. So keep it up. I appreciate you doing this morning and good luck. Is there anything, Brian, from your perspective, you know, Olympic trials are coming up next year. It's a pretty exciting year for swimming, right?
Yeah. Yeah, we got a fun year ahead just in general. I think from us on a personal, you know, note, we've got a great group in front of us. We got some great people coming in that, you know, I think we're going to have a great season overall. But, you know, from a swimming, this is like going into this year, this is like the most exciting time for the swimming world and for the rest of the world to see swimming.
Yeah.
That you know, there's going to be a lot on TV. World champs are coming up. It's going to be a fun time.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Good time to be a fan. And you know, I think we have got a really good group of people that have some motivation going into next year. And we have nobody qualified for trials right now, but we have a plan in place of, you know, places we're really targeting and meets really targeting. And, you know, I couldn't be more excited for the year ahead. I think it's going to be fun.
You think you'll get there pretty soon, Joe? Like, you think you'll get athletes coming through the door that say, hey, I want to be an Olympian?
I don't think we're that far away, to be honest. I do think the infrastructure is here from an academic standpoint. I mean, we have a fantastic university, and I think that's the initial part of it all.
Right.
And now it's just kind of the proof of the concept, right? Getting some athletes in here that have that commitment to the sport and have that passion, giving them or just really involving them in our program, having them develop through our program, and all it's going to take is one or two athletes to see that progress. And then it happens quick. So yeah, I really don't think we're far off, and we're super excited for that day when it comes.
Well, if you're an athlete on the team right now or next year, you're listening to this, knock on coach's door and be that person that says, I want to make an Olympic team. Be that person. You know, you got them there.
Make our day.
Yeah, exactly. They're in the building already. Someone just needs to knock on the door and let you know. So, all right. Good luck, guys. I appreciate you doing this.
Yeah, thanks, man. Brett. Appreciate it.
All right. Take care. Bye.